Unfortunately, I went to seminary. And when this was written, this text was written by Paul, he was not referring to the New Testament, because the New Testament didn't exist. He's referring to the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible. That there are writings that are in our New Testament which were written after Paul, and that the Gospels had not been, what's the word for it, recognized as being scripture as such, but rather stories. So that in this text, it's about the Old Testament, and that it is worthy for review and understanding. As I said, I hope you all had a very good Thanksgiving. This past Monday, I was called in to do a funeral service for a person who committed suicide. This is one of the tragedies of the season. As I understand it, in the city of Yonkers, two people committed suicide, workers. And the third one died at work from a heart attack. But the young man is relatively young in life now, 52 years of age, that whatever his burdens were, whatever his pain was, it was overwhelming, and there was no reconciliation except to remove himself. And the sad part is, it affects his whole family. His son, his mother is still alive, and those with him. It's a painful thing. That I've been thinking, after listening to a lecture recently, about what is the function of our faith? What does the faith mean to me, to us together, so to speak? And the author of this lecture said something very simple. Religion is a source of inspiration, a source of consolation. Do we have that in our lives together? As it says in Timothy, all scripture is inspired. You go, why do you go to church, so to speak? We're living in a culture that is busy doing many other things. What was more important, giving thanks on Thursday or going shopping on Black Friday? And the masses get is gathering to go to be inspired by the sales. And what inspires you? What inspires me? What is it about this faith that we still gather? What is the inspiration? Hopefully we come to hear words of comfort, words of hope. In my journey, I've been impressed when I talk to people, they find out that I'm a minister. They go, you're a minister? My church life was terrible. We were forced to say prayers, which I understand. I didn't like going to church. I was being told if I wasn't good enough, I was going to go you know where, and it's not to heaven. That's not going into the church life. That if we're all God's children, to quote a quote from a quote song, all God's children have a place in the choir. Some sing high and some sing low, and some don't sing well at all. That's me. But that we have a place. And God is not an angry God. I'm impressed how many people's understanding of God is of a God who is angry and punishing of how to get them because they did not act a certain way. That's not inspiring. That's not helpful. It's not making a person whole or understand that nature of God. It says in the text, Jesus says, be you perfect as our Father in heaven is perfect. Now the problem with that is, when you say the word perfect, how many of us consider ourselves perfect? So I can be raising my hand. Thank you. It doesn't mean flawless. be you whole as a person, as God is whole. How many people in our society, like that poor man whose service I did on Monday, was fragmented, who was divided, who had no sense of wholeness or well-being or completeness. And his only way to deal with it was to remove himself. That part of our faith is affirmation. To understand that we have a gift, which we've all been given. And how much does the gift cost? At one level, nothing at all. It's really given. On the other hand, it costs everything. It costs our well-being, our faith. That we hopefully are inspired by our presence together. We're inspired by the acts we do in the name of faith, in the name of our beliefs. That we're inspired by a loving, caring God who seeks our wholeness and well-being. On Tuesday morning, actually, on Monday morning, I did the service, Monday evening. On Monday morning, I delivered for this church 3 shopping carts full of food. That's a lot of food, folks. And I think we were the only church that bought baby food. That's inspiration. And 2 frozen turkeys, by the way. But that was a gift that came from us gathering. The folks at the Nebbing Community Center were impressed. And they were very thankful as they prepared the next day to distribute the food. That's part of being inspired. If there's someone who's touched your life, who's inspired you, and that's a person of church life, but who inspired you, who made a difference, who was a mentor, that's another word we use, a mentor. Hopefully in the church we mentor each other. We give that gift of inspiration, which may be in the form of ritual. The most important form is the person gathered to share the story. Do you remember your Sunday school teachers? Have you ever went to Sunday school? I'm not sure everyone did. Of who touched your life? One I mentioned before was Mrs. Burgess. Again, as a very young child, she must have been 9,000 years old. Now that I've gotten a little older, she seems a lot younger. But I remember one thing that she did. One time we had one of our classmates in the Sunday school had gotten sick, and we signed a get well card for that person. And the card was like this, and this one girl bent too close to the candle, and her hair caught fire. Mrs. Burgess went like that and put the fire out. That was an act of inspiration, that that woman had this courage. As a kid, we were all panicked, but she just put the hair out. I'm sure there's people in your life who shared your faith, who inspired you, who touched you. That our faith should be an inspiration. It should be a sense of hope and well-being, which can lead to consolation. Each one of us in our lives have experienced pain, hurt, and loss. It's part of living, unfortunately. But the idea is, again, that God is there to console us. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all consolation, who consoles us in all our affliction, so that we may be able to console those who Seven?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. I'm really good at math, by the way. Telling a seven-year-old, are you a communist? He may have been Jehovah's Witnesses, well, I know right now, but are you a communist? What kind of consolation is that? What kind of help is that? We are here because we have experienced pain in our lives. We've experienced the passing of loved ones. We've experienced changes in our lives physically and mentally and spiritually, which have not always been easy. And the idea of the consolation is we're not alone. That we're here to support each other as best we can, to share with each other a sense of hope, a sense of well-being. And even if I may, even death can be a point of transformation and liberation, a sense of hope for those who have faith. I'm not sure that a man had that kind of faith. But we are here to console, to be together. When we have our Lord's Supper, we have the various readings. We have the Apostles' Creed, our beliefs. We have also the Church Covenant about our sharing. And so I invite you to be people who are inspiring. Inspiring not in just the church, but inspiring in your journey in life. That what you've gotten from, what you have received, not gotten, received from your faith, you would share with someone else. I'm still learning that. I never stop learning that. Attitude, need, understanding, that we can be an inspiration to help other people. Sometimes being inspired, so to speak, is not to say anything, but to listen, to hear, not to explain, but to understand. And to be a consolation is a caring for those who don't understand their journeys. Consolation to say, I'm your friend. I'm here for you. Hopefully, as the word for church in Latin is ecclesia, ecclesiastical, those who are gathered in together. The early church, as we pointed out last Sunday, every time they gathered, they gave thanksgiving to inspire each other and to console each other. The first thanksgiving that was held by the pilgrims in 1621 was for consolation. They gave thanks that they were still together, that they survived, that they were not alone, that a God who was above them got them, helped them to get through, ultimately approved. Part of being consoled is to be able to receive consolation, even from someone who's different, or inspiration. So in this prelude between Thanksgiving and Christmas, may you be inspired by your faith. May you be inspired with someone you can remember who's touched your life. May you be inspired by something or some act that changed your life. Someone who stopped for you on the road of your life to help. To be an inspiration to someone else. And to be a consolation. When we share the feast, the shalom, that's consolation. That Christ is there to welcome us. When we share that simple word, it's not me just speaking, it's Christ speaking through each one of us. And we can be a consolation, gives welcome, well-being, and peace. May you have it this Sunday and every day.